Rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful still. This is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 25 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. Quick caveat before we get started, I did have a little bit of a technical issue with the guest track right around the 10 minute 30 second mark where there's a little bit, actually a lot of an echo, and I fixed it as best as I was able in post-production, but our guest has such an amazing voice, it actually sounds like he's in a stadium, so it shouldn't detract too much from the message, but you've been warned. So, as this podcast airs in mid-March 2017, it is one day, just one, before the launch of Social Media Marketing World 2017 in San Diego. And as such, all of the early bird pricing is over. All gone. If you want to get tickets, you're gonna pay full price. However, you can still get in-person tickets as well as virtual tickets in the links in the show notes, and I would greatly appreciate it if you did purchase via those links. That support really helps the show. And so to celebrate, we've been showcasing speakers at this year's conference for the last five business days, including Park Howell, Brian Fanzo, Rev Ciancio, Jay Acunzo, which all culminates today with none other than Mr. Scott Monty. For 6 years, Scott was global head of social media at Ford Motor Company, where he advised on digital activities across the company, including crisis communications, influencer relations, marketing, customer service, and internal communications. His clients have included Walmart, Google, IBM, Reebok, American Airlines, T-Mobile, and more. He has appeared on major news outlets including NBC, NPR, CNN, and The Wall Street Journal. And The Economist ranked him number one atop the list of 25 social business leaders. And just as a quick side note, Scott is also a Sherlock Holmes aficionado and has the best radio voice of anyone that I have personally communicated with. Like, I have a total guy crush on Scott's voice. I'm not even ashamed to say it. He just has one of those real iconic James Earl Jones, Sam Elliott voices. Like, man, I wish I sounded like that. But anyway, without further ado, let's get into our interview with Social Media Marketing World speaker, Scott Monty. Scott, thanks so much for joining me.
It's a pleasure, sir.
You have a LinkedIn and a record of success that most people will crawl over broken glass to get to. And it's really an inspiration what you were able to accomplish at Ford Motor Company. And to say that you're one of the most respected thought leaders in the space would be so criminally remiss, we may have to get Sherlock Holmes on a case, but more on him later. But nobody starts out that way. Everybody has to start somewhere. So tell us that story. Take us on that journey. When did you first get bit by the bug, and how did you become enchanted with marketing?
You mean you want me to take you through my own broken glass field?
Indeed.
Oh, it's not pretty. It's, I guess it goes way back, further than you would think with regard to a marketing career. And I'll take you through the journey here because it is meandering and yet it has some meaning. When I was in college, I had intended to go on to become a doctor. I was following a pre-med course of study, which essentially means you can major in whatever you want. And most pre-med students choose biology, chemistry, one of the sciences. And I decided that, look, if I was going to have a lifetime of science and science education through medicine, then I would like to get the most out of my undergraduate liberal arts degree, so I decided to try something else. When I was in high school, I had taken a couple of years of Latin, so I said, well, why don't I check out some of these courses in ancient Roman and Grecian times and see what that's all about in the classics department. And lo and behold, I took a couple of classics courses, and I was immediately hooked. You know, studying ancient literature and drama and history and, you know, political establishments and sports and architecture and all the rest. And I walked away with a classics degree. Now, I ended up going on to the first year of med school and realized very quickly that I was not cut out for the whole science thing. And I added an MBA with a concentration in healthcare management on top of that, so as not to just throw away the opportunity, and then moved on to the beginnings of a career in healthcare marketing. However, over time, I realized, as I look back, that classics education was so important to me because, first of all, it helped me become a better critical thinker, as I read an awful lot for the classes. It helped me become a better writer, right? And when you think about the worlds of communication and marketing, you really need to be a good critical thinker and a good writer to start. But more than that, I've realized over time, as I look at the challenges and the foibles and the successes that people had in the ancient world, really not that different from what we experience today. In other words, over the last couple of thousand years, even though technology has changed dramatically, human nature has remained constant. And if you can understand human nature, the basics that drive people and what they want, and it just, the same comes from psychology or sociology as well. If you can understand that, then you've really got the basics of what it takes to be a successful marketer, okay? So after the healthcare stint, I went on to do some consulting in the pharma, biotech, medical device area, and that worked well until September 11th came along and that deal-making market dried up. I landed at a B2B healthcare and broader health health services and technology marketing firm, and that's where I started to hear about this thing that we now know as social media. Back then, it was mostly blogging. You know, Facebook didn't exist yet. Twitter didn't exist yet. Even YouTube was just in its nascency at that point. But I realized there was something there, people connecting with other people, and that there would be an opportunity there. The agency, however, didn't really view it the same. They wanted to know where the revenue model was. And, you know, this was early days, 2006 or so. And I said, look, I don't know where the revenue model is, but if you get on board now, you'll have a leg up. You'll be able to be thought leaders so that when this does begin to turn into something more significant, you will have been there. And they weren't interested in that. They were interested in the revenue model. So I left there to go to a strategic consultancy that just did social media strategy for big brands. And I was working alongside Coca-Cola and American Airlines and Panasonic, brands like that. And lo and behold, I got a call from Ford Motor Company. And they said they were putting a new position in place at the corporate headquarters. It was an executive position. And they had heard about me and wanted me to come interview for the job. And long story short, a few months later, I took it and joined Ford in July of 2008, just before the whole global carpocalypse happened. And that was a ride and a half.
Right. That is an epic tale, to be sure. So if you had a time machine and you could go back and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum. Yes, I'm a fan of Doctor Who. What are the top three things that you would tell yourself to help prepare for your career?
Wow. Well, first of all, I must compliment you on how spacious it is inside this TARDIS. And I would say, I would repeat some advice that I got from one of my most respected mentors. And this was when I was at the healthcare consulting group doing biotech and medical device work. And I didn't really understand, I didn't fully comprehend the implications of what he said at the time. He said, you need to tell yourself you have arrived, right? And what he was trying to say, what he was trying to do was to instill me with more confidence and keep me from always looking for the next thing. And how am I going to tell when I'm successful? He said, you already are. You just need to tell yourself that you have arrived. And then what ends up happening is you need to, or you end up acting in a way that matches your thoughts, right? So, you know, there becomes a better sense of maturity, a better sense of confidence. You know, you begin to relate to people on a different level at that point. So that's one thing. And the other thing, from this same mentor, I didn't fully appreciate at the time, but I, again, reflecting back on experiences and lessons, so important. You know, I do the same thing when I think back on my classics education. I get more out of it now than I did then. But thinking back to many, many staff meetings at this company, watching Andy, that was my boss's name, watching Andy run those meetings, he was fairly silent throughout the entire thing. And he would go around and he would let everybody at the company talk. And it was a company of about 35 people or so. And when it came time to get Andy's opinion on something, everyone would be completely... just completely wrapped in attention and silence as they waited for him to speak. And the lesson to me there was, you don't always have to be forcing your opinion out there. You don't always have to be first to jump with a comment. Sometimes it's better to sit back and to just take it all in and then respond accordingly.
Gotcha. Very sound words. So now I'm going to ask you to look into the future, because one of the areas of digital marketing that I follow is mobile/Internet of Things and connected devices. And sort of the default example that everybody gives is the smart refrigerator that knows when you're out of milk and then automatically adds it to your shopping list, which is then delivered via Amazon drone. And in that example, that's what they call a closed loop system, because you don't actually have to leave the house in that scenario. It's kind of like the Jetsons. So how do you see marketing evolving as we go ever closer toward that Jetsons reality where everything is automated? You don't have to leave the house at all if you don't want to.
Well, I think the that view of the future is, first of all, it's way off. We're decades away from that being the norm. Because, look, one of the things we have to acknowledge, first and foremost, is that marketers, and particularly those that are focused on the tech sphere, tend to be a little bit isolated in their thinking. They tend to be in a bubble. And there's always this idealized future state. And when you look at even where we are today, based on where we were 5 years ago, it's still very much a mixed medium. It's not like print has gone away, for example. Print is still with us, and print is actually still very powerful. You know, just the ability to send somebody a handwritten note in this day and age, it stands out because they're used to seeing a lot of digital, but print still exists. So that being the case, looking into the future of marketing, I think what's much more important and what is much more, you know, potentially pending is the notion of personalization. We've been promised this for so long. That's part of what the era of social and digital was supposed to bring us, was a more personalized approach to marketing, where the brand would know you, would know your preferences, would know what you've been talking about on various platforms, and then would be able to craft messaging or offers or what you like in the places that matter to you. And where are we right now? We're still doing mass marketing just across a bunch of different platforms. And yeah, I understand that there's been some degree of personalization, particularly with regard to email, where it's probably the easiest to do, easiest to track. And there are companies right now that are working on better personalizing that marketing future, customer by customer. So I think that's what we need to focus on in the short term.
Gotcha, which leads into my next question. You, Gary Vee, and Brian Solis, or insert whichever thought leader if you happen to be at a different conference, you're all chilling at the bar after the conference, having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from the current professional digital marketing atmosphere, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
Well, I talk about this on a regular basis, and it is the lack of customer centricity. There's a lot of lip service given to being customer centric, but truly aligning your brand to customer needs is so important. I like to tell people that unless you are Starbucks or Dunkin' Donuts or insert your favorite coffee brand here, unless you are one of those, the customer does not wake up thinking about you first thing in the morning. Right? People have jobs, they have families, they have responsibilities. There are a million things going through their minds, through their screens, through their to-do lists every single day. And your brand is not the most important thing, despite what you may think. And yet, how do brands come to the table? How do brands present themselves? We're proud to announce, we're thrilled with, hey, look at us, look at me, look at what I'm doing. Rather than, how can I help? How can
can I provide value to this individual, to this exchange? How can I extend my brand to put the customer at the center of my messaging, to put the customer at the center of my product development, to put the customer at the center of everything I do? And it's all there. You know, we've got so much data about customers right now. There is no excuse for not fundamentally understanding what your customers' challenges are and being there to meet them in a non-self-centered way.
Absolutely, no excuse at all. So we are going to take a short break, and then when we get back, we're going to continue with Mr. Scott Monty, so stick with me. We've all heard the stories. New mom starts a blog while on maternity leave, and now she's a multimillionaire. Or the pizza boy with just a GED who now makes more than all of his teachers combined. Or that one guy that got stricken with some calamity that left him bedridden for 6 months or something like that. You get my point. Insert cliche here. They would all have you believe it's as simple as getting online, finding success, and living happily ever after. Rinse and repeat. And eternal optimist that you are, you think, why not me? And you fall for it. Hook, line, and sinker. You quickly find yourself completely overwhelmed with digital business operations, disappointed, and ultimately disenchanted with the whole online success fairy tale. Well, friends, you're not alone. Now, I can hear the groans of objection now. You're just being negative. Those stories are real. That really happens to people. And yeah, that has been known to happen. And people have also been known to win the lottery or marry their high school sweetheart after falling in love at first sight. But then you have the rest of us. Those stories often leave out the lucky breaks, support systems, and hard skills needed to truly achieve success online. I don't. Through the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, I've connected you with top thought leaders and real online professionals, not outliers who don't recognize themselves as such. Through these candid, no BS conversations, we discuss what it's really like to achieve success online and give you the tools and strategies to do the same. Did you know I'm also available to you for speaking engagements, digital discernment workshops, and even one-on-one Skype or telephone consults? Go to consulttemi.com and book me for your next event. That's consulttemi.com and click on the speaking tab. You see, being a real digital marketing professional doesn't have to be a pipe dream left unfulfilled, but you gotta take the rose-colored glasses off and get real. So go to consulttemi.com to book me, and I look forward to seeing you in person. And remember, tactics change, but principles don't. So don't get bewitched by the shiny ball syndrome. See you soon. And we're back. So, Scott, myself and my co-author wrote a book almost a year ago today called Beyond Buzzwords. And the buzzword of 2016 and still going strong in 2017 was influencer marketing, right? You had Convince and Convert that came out with a podcast, Influence Pros. And those in the space warned that we may see a train wreck here in the not-so-distant future. And we just got our first spectacular train wreck. Not a regular train wreck. I'm talking mushroom cloud, debris going everywhere, courtesy of one PewDiePie. So for those who don't know, PewDiePie is like the first YouTube success story / rags to riches story. He literally went from just a guy with a YouTube channel. Now he makes about $4 million a year. His YouTube channel was the first with a billion. That's a billion with a B. Views, and he previously had relationships with Disney, Maker, and a few others. And the reason I say previously is that PewDiePie fashions himself as sort of an amateur humorist, and so he decided to take jabs at the site Fiverr.com and the outrageous things that you can get people to do for as little as $5. But the way he chose to go about this was by commissioning people to do anti-Semitic things, which will not be repeated on the show. So my question to you is actually twofold. The first is, how do you see the fiasco surrounding PewDiePie's anti-Semitism influencing influencer marketing as a whole? Because Disney has actually received a bit of backlash for abandoning PewDiePie from the younger generation, and Chris Brogan actually made a really good point on the Marketing Companion podcast, which you did an amazing job of introing, by the way. Shout out to Tom Webster and Mark Schaefer. About how, you know, Chris's point was that the younger generation fundamentally uses language differently, and what offends us doesn't offend them. And the second part is that in this whole clickbaity internet that we find ourselves in, the trend has been toward ever more salacious and outrageous things. So do you think PewDiePie's antics has the danger of making others who are interested in monetizing influencer marketing behave more outlandishly?
Well, ultimately, I think it means that brands and their agencies in particular, because let's face it, the agencies are usually the ones that are doing the yeoman's work here. They're the ones doing the research, putting together the recommendations, putting together the agreements with these influencers. They need to be doing a better job screening. You know, the PewDiePie's antics over the recent history that made Disney flip out are nothing new. If you look back at his content, he's very consistent. You know, if he were suddenly acting in a way that he hadn't acted before, he'd be losing subscribers, right? So fundamentally understanding your influencer market, your influencer group, and spending time with these people, spending time watching their content, spending time participating as a member of their communities. You know, too many marketers treat influencers like a simple media buy. And it's much more nuanced and complex than that. And as a matter of fact, I don't even like the term influencer marketing. I know it's an industry accepted term, and because it usually is run through the marketing department, that's what it is. But it's treated like a marketing tactic rather than what it should be, which is influencer relations, which is more akin to media relations in a typical communications environment, where a PR representative is following the beat or the regular articles of a journalist and, you know, has lunch with them from time to time and understands what their challenges are and gives them opportunities to craft a story rather than just shoving stuff down their throat or paying them to do something, right? So I think that's where there's a potential opportunity for marketers and communicators to think about influencers more along the lines of influencer relations rather than moving that marketing tactic. Now, the question as to whether this is going to affect influencer marketing and the practice of it as a whole, my short answer would be I hope so. And I hope it would do so in a direction that causes brands to be more thoughtful and to do their homework before engaging with an influencer. It doesn't necessarily mean that influencer marketing is going away, that this is a failed marketing tactic. It was just a failure on the part of the institutions that hired this guy to do their jobs well.
Absolutely. So without getting political, you know, to the best of your ability, but by all means express yourself, because, you know, candor is the whole point of this podcast. What's your take on the whole fake news fallout and a subsequent crackdown on Facebook? And just to back up, in the last 3 months of the U.S. 2016 presidential election, fake news started to outperform real news on Facebook. And by fake news, I mean these stories were wholesale fabricated, had no factual basis in reality. It was not a simple matter of spinning the facts one direction or another. There were no underlying facts to be spun. And as soon as this came out, Mark Zuckerberg sort of played it off like, oh, no. It's highly unlikely Facebook had anything to do with the outcome of the election. And he has subsequently backtracked. In his February open letter, he stated that fake news has outstripped Facebook's capacity to govern it at present, and they are in the process of rolling out AI, which is artificial intelligence, and other means to, you know, third-party verify news sources. So this has sparked a very interesting debate within the digital marketing community, because you have some people who are straight First Amendment and it's like, no, Facebook is a platform only. They don't have any business trying to be the arbiters of truth. And then you have others who are like, Facebook is a digital property. And as a property owner, you are ultimately responsible for what goes on your property. It's no different than, let's say, you have a pool in your backyard, and while you're away on business, some knucklehead teenagers hop your fence so they can go skinny dipping in your pool, and one of them drowns. You were away on business. You put up a fence. They were trespassing. Doesn't matter. Happened on your property, you're responsible. So, again, on the marketing side of things, where do you stand on this whole fake news debate?
Well, fake news is a very real problem. And there's a layer over it now, thanks to President Trump, where fake news as a term is being thrown about very irresponsibly. The fake news that Donald Trump refers to is news that he doesn't like. News that comes from well-respected, Pulitzer Prize-winning news organizations that have entire research staffs. And yes, there's going to be bias in any of these sites, left, right, or center. There will always be a bias because they're written by humans. But fake news, true fake news, if you can get your head around that phrase, as you stated, it is news that has been invented. These are websites that were put up largely in the middle of 2016 that are designed to look like they are real news sites. The Seattle Tribune, for example. Somebody puts up seattletribune.com, and it looks like, it must be a well-respected Seattle newspaper. It's not. It's a website. And very clearly says that it's satire, or if you look at the site, it's very slanted and gives propaganda. And this happens on the left as well as the right. There are no innocent political leanings here. The challenge is that the world has become so polluted with fake news and with this talk now by our elected leaders of fake news that it's become almost meaningless. So Facebook is taking a stand now, a little late, but they are taking a stand, as you said, with AI, where there's going to be a flag next to the news that says it's disputed. And it'll tell you why it's disputed. If we had that 6 months ago, we might not be in the same situation we're in right now. If Facebook started addressing this early, and this harkens back to Zuckerberg's claim that Facebook is not a media property. He said, no, it's a technology platform. Well, it's both. It's like nothing that has come before. And Facebook needs to step up and take responsibility for it, which is finally what they're doing. So we'll see what the longer-term prospect is in terms of their ability to clamp down on this and to, you know, help people understand what it is that they're looking at. And Facebook doesn't necessarily need to be the arbiter of truth, but it needs to let people know that there are consequences to sharing unfounded material. And when you've got a commander-in-chief who is sharing conspiracy theories about the previous president, you know, you've already set the bar pretty high in terms of what needs to be overcome now, because people will believe anything they hear. It's sad. And even when you give them the truth, when you give them fact-checking sites, they tell you the fact-checking sites are fake news. And you can't even argue with that. It's absolutely ridiculous, the level of discourse that we've gotten to because of this.
Indeed. It's a sorry state if ever there was one. Last question, and I'll let you get back to your day. I want to be respectful of your time, but I am going to take just a few moments to set it up, because it's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his Entrepreneur on Fire podcast, but I'm steering it in a very deliberate direction, and I want you to understand why I'm asking it the way I'm asking it. So in my personal and professional opinion, there's a gap in the professional digital marketing education space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I mean someone who works in-house at a corporation or at an agency. I am not referring to digital entrepreneurship or solopreneurs, somebody like a Pat Flynn or a John Lee Dumas, even though you could absolutely make the case that they're pros because they operate at such a high level. It's not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs, people who get a W-2 at the end of the year. And when you're interested in breaking into the industry, you sort of start off meandering the wilds of Google. And while, yes, there's a lot of good information out there, contrary to popular belief, rooting it out actually does take a little bit of skill. You might land on Convince and Convert. You might end up doing Amway. Like, who knows? And so you do that for a while, and you can do what I did, which is go back and get a degree in internet marketing. But the cons with that is that it's very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000 to get my undergraduate, and it's time consuming because even though my degree program was accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete. And in the digital marketing landscape, 30 months is several lifetimes. But by far the most prevalent way that people educate themselves and disseminate best-in-class practices is through conferences and seminars. The issue there is that even though in aggregate it's a lot cheaper than getting a degree, you have to have that money up front. So take some of your better conferences like a South by Southwest or a MozCon or a Social Media Marketing World, you're looking at between $500 and $1,500 just to get through the door. That doesn't include your flight, your hotel, Uber, food for how many days. Once you add all that other stuff back in, you're looking at between $3,000 and $5,000 on a single conference. And a lot of people are in life situations where, you know, they just can't swing it. So I'm trying to crowdsource, if you will, a way of professionalizing oneself that does not include selling your firstborn to the Department of Education, meandering the wilds of Google, rolling the dice, or coming out of pocket $5,000, which a lot of people are just not able to do. So now that I've just rambled for however long, I'll ask the actual question, which is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skill, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right, you are college freshman broke, Scott. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer, Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
Wow. I thought this was going to be an easy question. Usually you get to the last question. It's like, just take it home. That is a really good question. So here's a couple of things. First of all, we're in a much better place in 2017 than we were 10, 15 years ago, when it was truly the Wild West, when those of us who were just cutting our teeth in digital had to find our own way. You know, we had to forge a path. Even when I was at Ford from 2008 to 2014, I likened it to paving the road behind us. You know, this is part of what makes you stand out in a particular field, is that you blaze a trail and that there isn't anything scripted for you. So, and I realize that there are certain things you need to do to block and tackle, certain basics that you need to put in place to get to that point. I'm not suggesting that people just blindly go out and do whatever they feel like. But now we've got tools out there like, I'll take Hootsuite Academy, for example. I'm actually on the advisory board for this. They have free online courses that you can take, from, you know, social media training to, you know, understanding paid media. Of course, they do advanced certification as well. So there's a way to step up there. But that's an opportunity to get your kind of dip a toe in, for example. And there are plenty of other online courses that you can take for free. So that's one step in terms of self-education. In terms of building the relationships, you know, I think to a certain extent you can rely on Google, you know, looking for who the respected experts are in any particular field. You can look through Wikipedia. You can do a simple Google search. You can start reading some blogs and see what other links people are sending you to. You kind of have to put on the magnifying glass and snoop your way around, because a lot of this is, there is no single best way to do it. You're going to find what works for you. And the more you can find people that are well-respected in the industry and that have a significant track record, because there are plenty of people out there who have been, you know, quote-unquote, social media experts for their entire career, and yet they've never worked for a brand or had a major brand as a significant client. You have to be careful about those kinds of experts that are out there. But following your nose and finding out who is respected, who the links go to, and taking the time to get to know those people. Part of what I did 10, 15 years ago is I started my own blog, but in order to get people to read my blog, I read theirs. Probably at like a 6-to-1 ratio. I'd spend more time reading than writing. And I would comment. And I know blog comments are a quaint, distant thing of the past, but they still matter. Right? Letting people know that you appreciate their effort, their content, their knowledge. Asking them to connect with you. Asking them to be on your show. Right? Just like you did, Temi. This is the way you build relationships. This is the way you become more well-educated, more well-rounded to hopefully present yourself to, you know, your next boss or your next opportunity as someone who knows something about the space that you're trying to break into.
Absolutely. This has been tremendous, Scott. Thank you so much for your time. Please take a moment. Tell us about what you got going on at Brain Trust Partners. Tell us about your podcast, your social media handles. Where can we get some more of you?
Thanks. Well, Brain Trust, which is at braintrust.partners, is a strategic executive consultancy. We work with platform companies and marketers to help them get the best out of what they're trying to do digitally. And a lot of that comes through digital transformation efforts. And we're comprised of individuals who have done this on the brand side. So bringing a whole lot of experience and information to the table. You can check us out again at braintrust.partners. And then every Monday, I put out a newsletter called The Full Monty. You can find it at fullmontyshow.com. And it comes with a side of podcast. Every Wednesday, I put out an episode that kind of acts as a complement to the newsletter. The newsletter is really a roundup of curated links and commentary. And then the podcast is more of a deep dive in terms of a commentary about something there. So check that out at fullmontyshow.com. And you can find me everywhere on social media as Scott Monty.
And there you have it, folks. Braintrust.partners. Your colleague Tim Hayden's episode actually dropped today as we're recording this. So Frank, Angus, Christopher, be warned, I am coming for you. So Scott, thank you so much.
It's been such a pleasure, Temi. Thank you for your thoughtful questions.
If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. It really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.